The Republic of Georgia, sometimes hailed as the Caucasus' most democratic state, has grown accustomed to living with external threats. The growing ambitions of neighbouring Russia and of breakaway regions, Abkhazia and South Ossetia, pose a challenge that would make any small nation uneasy. But is the toxic feuding of a former president and a powerful oligarch now undermining Georgia's internal stability to a dangerous degree? Filmmaker Glenn Ellis went to find out.
Nestling between the North and South Caucasus Mountains, the former Soviet Republic of Georgia is breathtakingly beautiful. Filled with remote villages where, in many ways, life has barely changed for centuries. Widely viewed as the most democratic country in the Caucasus, it is now in the grip of a deadly power game. Former President Mikhail Saakashvili, the charismatic politician once lauded in the West for bringing democracy to Georgia, is locked in a toxic feud with the country's richest oligarch, Bidzana Ivanishvili. It's a power struggle that could tear the country apart. The Georgian army is on a permanent state of high alert. But since the Ukrainian crisis, even this has been ratcheted up. These troops are training for urban warfare. Since winning independence in 1991, Georgia has fought two wars with Russia, losing territory to the Russian-backed breakaway republics of Abkhazia and South Ossetia in what are now called frozen conflicts. But are these conflicts in danger of heating up?
So Russians are staying not so far from Tbilisi. He can reach Tbilisi in half hour with his tanks, and it's for sure everyday problem for Georgia. I would say it is maybe somehow frozen conflict, but we are still with Russia in the war.
This is the village of Kirabali in North Georgia, where, as strange as it sounds, villagers are being kidnapped by Russian soldiers and held to ransom. Georgia's political elite couldn't have picked a worse time to declare war on each other. Sitting on a hilltop overlooking Tbilisi, there's a sleek glass castle any James Bond villain would be proud of. Its owner, Bidzana Ivanishvili, nicknamed the Secretive One, is the man many believe holds the key to his country's future. Little is known of how he amassed his billions in Russia, little more about the man himself, apart from a private zoo and a priceless collection of modern art.
He is an exceptional person, of course. And if you want so, he had a very close cooperation with the previous government in the first years of Saakashvili government. And he helped them a lot. He helped Saakashvili with advice, and he helps Saakashvili with finances.
He somehow keeps this mystery around him, what he really wants, what's he really after. And it was also very unexpected move when he decided to join politics.
2 years ago, Ivanishvili stepped into the spotlight.
Boris Eltsinis archivnes vapinasebdi me, moakherkhe is rom kommunistebs ar moetsat sashvoleba dabrunebisa.
The oligarch launched his Georgian Dream coalition. He turned his back on Saakashvili's government, accusing it of rampant human rights abuses, and trounced the president's United National Movement in parliamentary elections. Georgia's richest man became its prime minister. Key to his success was the endorsement of the church. Ivanishvili paid for the building of Tbilisi's magnificent Orthodox Cathedral. In this deeply religious country, the patriarch Ilya II carries more weight than anyone else. He preaches a staunchly conservative brand of orthodoxy, strong on tradition and anti-European.
Despite Saakashvili's advances to the church, they really hated him because he was a symbol of these westernizing ideas which undermined, in their eyes, Georgian traditions and culture, etc. So now comes Ivanishvili, who is kind of savior from Saakashvili.
Last year, the patriarch met with Vladimir Putin, who many Orthodox Christians view as a bulwark against Western decadence. Once elected, Ivanishvili wasted no time in pursuing his political opponents. His claim that Saakashvili's enemies were tortured appeared to be backed up by chilling footage filmed by a former prison guard, which included killings allegedly ordered by Georgia's interior minister.
There are a lot of video recordings how people were raped, how people were tortured, and how they were treated. We have evidences that the high officials of previous government were involved in the torture of this person, and the case is now pending before the court.
Now based in New York, the former president, who in 2013 was barred from seeking a third term, claims the videos were a stunt.
It was staged. It was staged for a particular purpose. It was paid for, staged, kept for 1 year at least, and then released just before elections. I mean, the whole staging procedure took place around the time when Ivanishvili announced that he's running for the office.
What is clear is that the former president increased the prison population threefold. Ironically, now much of his government is behind bars too.
Are they all guilty?
They are. And not only them, but many other people. But this is the mistake of Georgian Dream. They didn't create investigative commission 2 years ago. They had to do it. It's like Pinochet regime. So you can't prove to foreigners everything if you don't investigate in all details. And they didn't.
Nowadays, the grandiose headquarters of Saakashvili's United National Movement has a somewhat haunted feel about it. Many of his former associates claim there's a witch hunt going on.
I feel a bit awkward not being in prison, but the new government, and to be more precise, the oligarch who controls the new government, has a declared goal, publicly declared goal, to eliminate major political rival from the political scene and to put all the leaders in jail unless they shut up, and that has been publicly declared.
There is also a worrying trend of violence against Ivanishvili's political opponents. Aleko Tichishvili, director of the Georgian Human Rights Center, is concerned that the perpetrators are not being pursued.
Ivanishvili
stepped down as Prime Minister last November, installing a business associate as his replacement. Another nominee, Georgi Margvelashvili, was elected president that same month. But few doubt Ivanishvili continues to be the power behind the throne.
For him, it was another operation. He acquired Georgia as another company. somehow settled management affairs for 1 year and then put his most trusted aide to its day-to-day governance.
Meanwhile, the once popular former president, seen here addressing an anti-Putin rally in Kiev last March, is now a wanted man in Georgia. The wily politician is refusing to return to Tbilisi.
Would you feel safe if you were in Georgia now?
No, of course not. In Georgia, that's very clear that they want to arrest me. They just seized my personal property and property of my relatives. And nobody has illusions in Georgia that's purely political. It's a vendetta. The problem is that when you do old-fashioned vendettas in a country that's trying to be a modern, performing democracy, it's conflict by itself and it's going to erupt.
Saakashvili was immensely popular with Western politicians who showered his regime with praise.
Georgia is today both sovereign and free and a beacon of liberty for this region and the world.
But some argue that the West turned a blind eye to Saakashvili's authoritarian streak.
There is a radically different vision from outside and from inside.
During Saakashvili's premiership, peaceful demonstrations were brutally put down. Political rivals sometimes died in mysterious circumstances, and press freedom was curtailed. But has the situation improved? The body of TV executive Erosi Kitsmarashvili was found last January slumped in his car in the garage of his Tbilisi apartment, shot in the head. The official line, suicide.
The camera room is Aris and Telam Helasiv Cheshiko, Makanas Sakmal Dahlos, Taisiko, Gozemitre, Buliano Missi, Hedus Diapazoni, the Rakus, yes, it got. Იყო სხვა მხარეს მიშველი. ხა ეს რას ნიშნავს, რატო იქნა, ვინ გააკეთა, როდის გააკეთა, ამაზე ვერაფერი გეტყვით.
Kitsmarashvili was a co-founder of Rastavi TV, Georgia's largest independent TV station, and a long-standing critic of Ivanishvili's Georgian Dream Enterprise.
Ამდენადაც სამწუხაროდ გამოძიების პროცესი არ არის გამჭვირვალე, საზოგადოებას რა კითხვებიც აქვს, მასზე პასუხები არ არის გაცემული. Მით უფრო ვინც იცნობდა ეროს კიცმარაშვილს, მე თვითონაც პროფესიით ჟურნალისტი ვარ და საკმაოდ კარგად ვიცი თუ როგორი ხასიათის იყო ეს ადამიანი, მათთვის თვითკვლელობით რომ დაესრულებინა მას სიცოცხლე მართლა წარმოუდგენელია.
Ivanishvili's power and influence in Georgia appear unstoppable. In political terms, the country has undergone a seismic power shift from a Western-leaning president to an oligarch. But how will this affect a region already riddled with seething fault lines?
We are surrounded by three big whales, Russia, Turkey and Iran. And if you ask a regular Persian man or regular Turkish man or regular Russian man, what is Georgia? All of them will answer that Georgia is historical part of Persia or Turkey or Russia, which by some historical misunderstanding they have lost, but one day it will be back.
The last time Russia invaded Georgia was in 2008, supporting separatists in a manner all too similar to that recently seen in Ukraine.
We are a small country in a very dangerous neighborhood. If there is strong determination, it's possible to move forward without being directly, you know, attacked by Russia. But of course, this is always the problem.
There are 500,000 internally displaced people in Georgia from wars with Russia, over 10% of the population. Like Amiran Guguchichvili, who showed us around all that's left of his house right on the red line, burned by Russian soldiers in the 2008 conflict.
Roberts Gaigle,
Now, Amaran lives with five others in one room at a disused school. Georgia's relationship with Russia has been a troubled one, but there's more to this than meets the eye. This museum complex in the town of Gori, some 40 minutes from the capital, Tbilisi, is built around the house where Georgia's most famous son was born.
This mask was made from Stalin's death face, made of bronze. In the world exist 9 copies of the masks. Every mask was made from the previous mask, made from his death face. That's why it's smaller than the original one.
We had somebody, maybe very, very bad guy, maybe worst dictator in the world, but still he was Georgian. So Russians was pressing us, but our boy, Stalin, was pressing Russia and Soviet Union whole. And so it is very primitive thinking, but still existing, especially by old people.
Stalin is popular even amongst those who suffered at his hands. Baron Baramidze was deported to Kazakhstan by Stalin. His father was sent to the Gulag.
Stalin's there. Man Sakartvelos Houtana didi ubedureba. Da amas Sakartvelo dghesas ganitsdis. Magram me vtuli rom is msopulios ert-erti uzlieresi da upirvelesi pirovneba iqo.
Indeed, parts of Georgia still live with Stalin's legacy of mass industrialization. Now mostly derelict. But it wasn't all bad during communism. Georgian wine was widely drunk across the USSR. Wine production here is believed to be the oldest in the world, dating back 8,000 years, and understandably plays a central role in Georgian culture. But even this suffered a major body blow when Putin imposed a wine embargo 8 years ago.
Russian state in its nature is an aggressive state. Once Russia somehow accomplished, at least temporarily, its their at least provisional tasks with Ukraine, then they of course will turn their heads again towards Georgia.
Russian troops already occupy 1/5 of Georgia. Last November, they embarked on a new expansion of this territory with the erection of border fences far south of the accepted red line. Villagers were told that their homes were on the wrong side of the border and they would have to move. Julieta Makarishvili's experience is typical.
Territoria chwenia u khoda albat sakhlebi daangreda tsaiget ratsa gaqs de gaqatsa ru agara peri gekneba da arame gabrazebuli khan mara kho nerviulo para qela mesi ari vitsi para gitkhamedi akhali tskhorebas ro daiqeb rogori ikneba.
Dvorny is just one of several communities that have been cut in two. Unarmed EU monitors patrol the region, doing what they can to support villagers. But it's clear that there is no appetite for confrontation with Russia. After all, the lights of Europe would simply go out without Russian gas. However, a massive new gas pipeline project could help break this dependency. The capacity of BP's South Caucasus pipeline, which carries gas from Azerbaijan, is being increased threefold and will soon be bringing gas directly from the Caspian Sea to Europe for the first time, seriously undermining Russia's stranglehold over the market. Many are wondering how Putin will react.
Of course, it can be a game changer, and Europe is very much interested to diversify the gas supply. And we are also building a Baku-Tbilisi-Kars railway. And this economic but also geopolitical projects will play an important role in the future economic development of our country and will be a factor for stabilization and security for our region. To threaten somehow this pipeline has not only economic dimension but also a political one.
This new railway, dubbed the Iron Silk Road, will give China direct access to Europe with an estimated $75 billion trade flow, bypassing Russia, which until now has had a monopoly on all rail freight from China. It's impossible to overstate the importance of these developments for Europe's trade and energy security. The one snag, they both pass through a pro-Russian region of Georgia, the spectacular Javakheti Plateau, which is scattered with villages populated mostly by ethnic Armenians, many of whom hark back to the good old days of the Soviet Union, complaining that Tbilisi's policy of integration is destroying their culture.
Но на самом деле вот этот процесс интеграции приводит к ассимиляции. Потому что я сказал, вот логически сказал, что в советский период мы имели культурную автономию. Сейчас мы теряем эту автономию. Оттуда и наша боль. Ну, конечно, это не проблема властей. У них ничего не болит.
There has been much speculation over the number of Russian passport holders in this region, which some estimate at a third of the population, not least because Putin's excuse for seizing Crimea was to protect Russian citizens living abroad.
Provoking conflicts in their neighborhood is a traditional item of Moscow's foreign political toolkit. And then, you know, they have in their strategic documents and doctrines necessity and obligation of protection Russian citizens abroad, including by using of a military means.
As the war in Ukraine drags on, and with Georgia now effectively being run by an oligarch with strong links to the Kremlin, whose agenda is at best worryingly ambiguous, many fear what will happen next.
I think it's very dangerous because Putin and his team is consumed with Ukraine challenge. But we know very well from our recent past and from fundamental attitude of Putin and his team and Kremlin that Georgian statehood and sovereignty, just as sovereignty of any of its neighbors, is not accepted per se by Kremlin. And part of his grand revisionist agenda is to revisit the outcomes of the Cold War and to challenge the core European security. So part of it is regaining back control of all the, former Soviet Union space.
And with Georgia's two most powerful politicians at each other's throats, Georgia could be playing straight into Putin's hands.
It is also a battle really between personalities. They don't like each other, but still we have to learn in this country how it is possible to cooperate with each other when the country is in danger.
In the woods around Tbilisi, veterans from Georgia's recent wars with Russia meet and remember fallen comrades. The mood is somber.
What are you going to do? No, მე არავის ჩეკმის ქვეშ ყოფნას არ ვაპირებ. ამისათვის რუსეთი რო აპირებს საქართველოს ისევ თავის სფეროში მოყოლებას, ჩვენ რაც შეიძლება მეც გავაკეთებთ იმისათვის, რომ წინ აღუდგეთ ამას. და მანამ დავიღუპები, ბევრი არის კიდევ ასეთი, რომელიც მასე ფიქრობს, ძალიან ბევრი სხვა ხალხიც დაიღუპება.
After this film had been completed, Maya Panjikidze, Georgia's pro-West foreign minister, resigned. Her party, the Free Democrats, which advocates stronger ties with NATO and the EU, has quit the Georgian Dream coalition, claiming Georgia's European integration is under threat.